method, or I can say these are the methods which are being implemented for surface elimination as well. So under which this particular methods come, can someone tell? We studied two different parts right yesterday, under which this algorithm comes. Can someone tell me what are those methods? No, don't remember. Okay, as I told in yesterday's class, basically backface as well as depth buffer method basically comes under object space method as well as image space method. So these are the two algorithms which are being implemented with respect to the visible surface detection. So we'll see the algorithm step by step, how this algorithm works, how the detection of visible surface is done. Coming on to the first algorithm, that is backface algorithm or backface detection. As I told, there are two algorithms used in this method, that is visible surface detection. What basically this algorithm does, to be simpler, this algorithms are used to identify the visible as well as invisible areas or the surfaces with respect to the object which you have been fed as an input to that particular model. For the first algorithm, which is backface algorithm, which is also called as backface detection, what is the criteria with respect to this backface detection is basically it actually consists of some buffer. First it will take the buffer, which is actually similar to depth buffer as well. It basically consider that particular buffer, and then it will store the area which is being actually applied onto the object with the help of visible or invisible surfaces. Once that buffer is being created, that kind of buffer is being removed so that you can actually initialize that particular buffer with another memory which consists of some values. So we'll check out one step by step how this backface detection is done. Backface is, it is actually a method which is used to remove backface of any object. So this is the functionality of backface detection. Backface detection is basically used to remove the backface. What do you mean by backface? The area which is actually behind the particular object, with the help of which you can find out the areas regarding the connected points with respect to that particular object. As I told, it is basically used to remove excuse me, students. It is basically used to remove backface of any object. Then this method is like a preprocessor that removes backface in a method. That is, if you want, if you have studied machine learning, what is the first step of machine learning? When you are passing some data, you will basically preprocess the data. Why? In that particular data, because you want to clean out some impurities in that. So we'll be using pre-processing in that. So this is actually similar to that. This method is will act as a pre-processor, which actually removes the backface in any kind of method. That is the area which is behind the surface, it will remove that particular area. It is also called as a fast as well as simple object space method for identifying the backfaces of an object, which is based on inside-outside test. As we studied in module 2, we had some inside-outside tests for finding out the faces of an object. Similarly, in backface detection algorithm, as it is an object space method, which is used to identify the backface of an object, it uses some inside-outside tests so that it will identify that backface detection. So what are these inside and outside tests? So check out how backface works in this example. Students, just a second. Yeah. Suppose this is an observer. I will take the viewer as an eye. I is an observer of that particular object. The viewing window of that particular viewer with respect to eye looks like this if this is an object given to it. With respect to this viewer, what happens is whenever the viewer's position is towards that particular object, if if it is in this direction, that is the sideway direction, the viewer will be able to see this face of that particular object, which I actually called as an world coordinates, with the help of which object is being represented. So in this algorithm, which is a back face algorithm, if the viewer is located in this position, he will not be able to look at the back area of that particular object. So this area can be eliminated at any time because it is not actually considerable with respect to the viewer. So this is how back face works. It will just eliminate the area which is not visible to it, and then it will calculate which are the visible areas with respect to that particular object and what are the patterns which have been hidden inside that particular world coordinates of the object. So simultaneously, if I use this as a cube, which consists of huge number of cubes in it, if the viewer is in this position, he can just view this, almost this area, but he can't view the inner areas, that is the backside areas with respect to that particular object. Then, as I told, back face detection uses inside and outside tests. So what is that inside and outside test? We'll check out. In this inside and outside test, it basically gives some statements. What is that statement is, in an inside as well as outside test, a point XYZ is inside a polygon. Suppose if you are taking an example of polygon, you will be assuming a point. You have detected one point. That point will be inside that polygon, which you can name it as X, Y as well as Z. With respect to some surface with plane parameters A, B, C and D, if when an inside point is along the straight line to the surface, the polygon must be a back face. So check out the line. When an inside point is along the straight line of the surface, that is, take an example. This is a polygon. I have defined one point inside the polygon. I will name it as XYZ, but it consists of some parameters ABCD inside the plane. So I'll be naming it as ABCD. Then an inside point, that is, if this is an inside point here, this is basically the inner representation of the object where view of that particular point is being defined with respect to XYZ, which consists of some parameter 100. So if this point is inside a polygon surface, if that particular point is along the line, if you are drawing with respect to the object, then the polygon must be the back face. That is, if this is point is along with the line, straight line you are drawing to that particular surface, I can tell the area, that is, this area is the back face of the polygon. So this is how inside and outside test take some assumptions and do the inside and outside test so that it will detect the back face of an object. So we know that the polygon surface equation, the polygon equation is as follows: ax plus by plus cz plus d, where d is a constant, is lesser than 0. Then the point inside polygon surface, so it is back of the front face, can be eliminated. That is, with respect to this equation, by considering this equation, as we got to know, the inside point is, if it is along with the straight line which you have drawn there, then I can tell this is the back end of an object with respect to the viewer, and this area can be eliminated so that you will get just the front face of the particular polygon. So that was about the back face detection with the help of inside and outside tests. Similarly, in back face detection, there is another method called as surface is back face. This is this might be asked for a 5-5 marker question. That is, the test, the question might be, explain back face detection algorithm, and then what are the methodologies used in back face algorithm? One is inside and outside test, which is very simple, and then another is surface as its back face. So what happens in this method is, it will basically consider a normal vector, which is named a Cartesian components ABC, which consists of components A, B and C. Now, how this vector is represented with respect to the polygon surface is, it will view, that is, we view as a vector in the viewing direction from the camera or an eye. The view that is V is basically represented from the point where the viewer is located or the camera is located. That is nothing but, it basically gives the direction of an I, that is, if this is the position of an, if I consider it as a camera, if this is the camera, this view basically represents the direction where the camera is located. Then it consists of some conditions there. That is, with respect to this condition, if the viewing direction from an I position, the, how the polygon surface back face is detected. First, it will take the product of the number of polygon surfaces. That is, with respect to this point, it will just take a product of this direction V view as well as N. If the product of these two is greater than zero, then V view will be assigned to this, where the Z coordinates would be given with respect to the vector V, and the N, the whole formula of N will be given by AX plus BY plus CZ. So how the product, as I got the two values of this, I should take the product of both. Once I take the product of both, I will get this value, that is VZ into C, where VZ will be actually equated to 1, which is an initial value of this. So finally, the product of this will be equated to C. That is nothing but the coordinate with respect to which the polygon is being defined. So this will be the surface formula with the help of which you will find out the back face. Then, as I told, that is, whatever we got C value here, the product of V view as well as N, which is nothing but a vector, normal vector, as C. There, we have conditions for C as well to be remembered. Suppose if C's value is greater than or equal to zero, then the surface is black. The surface is back, which is invisible. That is, the invisible area is being calculated with respect to this condition. If the sign C, that is the value of C, is lesser than zero, then you will get the visible part of that particular polygon. Now, I can say, what is the condition taken with respect to the algorithm? What we have to do? I have to eliminate the invisible lines, right? So, which condition will be taken? Which condition will be taken so that I can get the back face of that particular polygon? Can you tell me? Which condition will be considered? Are you all there?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. Tell me, which condition will be considered so that I will get the back face of the polygon?
First one.
Yeah, it's the first one. It is already written there, right? You will get the surface which has the back face, which is actually the invisible area. If whatever you have calculated, the product of the resultant of that particular product, if it is greater than or equal to zero, then I will get the back face of that particular polygon. So that was about the back face detection methods, which had two methods inside it for calculating back face of the polygon. Then we have some limitations regarding back face detection, where and all it is used, why it is not used in much areas. What are the limitations of back face detection? Is it is used only for solid or objects which are actually modeled as a polygon mesh. That is, it is actually used only for the objects which looks like solid. That is, like a square, like a cube, like whatever comes under a polygon. So it is applicable for such kind of models. Then, problematic for concave polyhedra. That is, apart from polygon, if you are trying to implement backface method for any other type of model, such as concave polygons, it is actually not considerable. So what is an example for concave polyhedron? A partially hidden face which is not eliminated by backface removal. See, check out. If you stand at this position and look out for the object, you can see some part of the backface, right? That is this. This is the little part which is being seen to you as a backface. So it is not considerable for such kind of examples. Suppose this is a whole cube I have defined here. It is applicable for such kind of model. So this is actually some of the limitations of backface detection. Then some advantages as well as disadvantages for depth buffer. Just a second. Yeah, backface detection algorithm. Some of the examples regarding that, one is advantage, that is always works with respect to a simple implementation which is actually used in the hardware part. Some of the disadvantages, large memory requirements is used for such kind of algorithm. So this algorithm, whatever depth buffer algorithm, or I can call it as an this algorithm as well, backface detection algorithm. So this this is an important question regarding to your internals. This backface detection is also called as Z buffer algorithm as well, with respect to detection algorithms. Okay, do remember students, backface, if it is asked for the 5 markers, 8 markers, or 10 markers, the backface algorithm is very important here. Okay, then then as I told, there are some visibility detection functions which should be considered for calling your OpenGL software, to be used in OpenGL software. We'll go through what are these functionalities. As I told, visible surface detection methods. First, we saw how the classification is done. Then we saw the method called as depth buffer method. The another name for depth buffer method is actually the backface detection algorithm also. That is, if the question is asked, explain backface detection algorithm. So you need to explain the depth buffer method in that as well. Okay. So with respect to this, as I told, there are some advantages as well as disadvantages as well. So this might be also as the advantages as well as disadvantages also. Okay. Do you people have any doubts regarding the depth buffer algorithm? How the algorithm works? What are the conditions? What are the inside methodologies used in backface detection, that is Z buffer method? Do you have any doubts? I will also be silent till you people be silent. Okay, I will also not tell anything for you. Students, I have asked you something. Do you have any doubts regarding the backface detection?
No, sir.
Z buffer method. Don't confuse yourself. If the question is asked for Z buffer method also, depth buffer method also, so you have to explain the same algorithm. Okay. So we'll move on to the next part, which is OpenGL functionalities with respect to. Yeah, with respect to visibility detection, we'll study how OpenGL visibility detection function works. So what are the different functionalities which are being mentioned in the syllabus with respect to visibility detection? Is one is OpenGL polygon culling function. The another one is OpenGL depth buffer functions, OpenGL wireframe surface visibility methods, as well as depth queuing functionalities. So these are the four important functions which are being defined in OpenGL visibility detection function. So we'll study in detail each and every detection functionalities one by one. So the first one is OpenGL polygon culling function. So what is this polygon function used for? Why is this polygon function used for? It is actually an backface removal functionality which uses some of the functionalities such as GL enable this function. If you want to define OpenGL polygon culling functions, you should enable that particular function, that is GL culling phase function, and then call that particular function with respect to some modes there. So once you enable this function, that is OpenGL polygon culling function, so it has some parameters with respect to the mode you have assigned there. You have assigned this as parameters, right? So I can tell this is a value which I have given for this callback function, that is GL culling phase function. So So what are the parameters mode which are assigned to this particular value? I can give the values as GL back, that is the back face of that particular polygon, GL front, that is front face of the polygon, front and back. I can specify both the faces of particular polygon. So this is how GL call face mode works. Then what is the default value for that parameter mode in this functionality? By default, parameter mode in the face function has the callback value GL back. So you will be using the initial value as GL back for finding the back face function. As this is the back face removal function, that is, this is used for removing the back face of a particular polygon, the initial value for that particular functionality is GL back. Then the culling routine is turned off with GL disabled with this particular functionality again inside it. So where this comes under GL enable as well as GL disable. If you want to enable the OpenGL polygon culling function, you should use GL enable GL culling phase. And then if you want to disable this particular function, you have to use this command called GL disable GL culling phase, which is basically used to remove the back face of a polygon. Then we have some depth buffer methods. Whatever the function, whatever the algorithm we study, that is depth buffer method or Z buffer method, we have some functionalities for that as well, which consists of buffer area, that is the memory. To use the OpenGL depth buffer visibility detection routines, we first need to modify the glut initialization function, that is the display mode, to include a request for a depth buffer as well as for the refresh buffer. As we study, as we have studied, we'll be using this function in each and every program, right? So what does this tell? You are just initializing the glut library with some buffer which consists of this particular display mode, that is glut singer, glut RGB, and then glut depth buffer. So here comes the depth buffer function, which basically tells you gives the request to the software to initialize the depth buffer so that I can refresh that buffer every time. So this is what this particular statement says. Then we have a GL clear as well. We have seen this also. What does this does? Basically, it gives a value which should be initialized for that particular library, that is glut library. What does this happens here? GL depth buffer, GL clear depth buffer bit. This basically clears the value which are already initialized in the memory, that is nothing but buffer. The initialization sets of all depth buffer values, the maximum value is 1.0 by default. That is, the maximum value of this buffer bit, that is depth buffer, is always 1. That is, the maximum value given to it is 1 usually. Then, the OpenGL depth buffer visibility detection routines are activated with the following function, that is GL enable GL depth test, and we'll deactivate that functions with GL disable GL depth test. That is, whenever you are using depth buffer functions in the program, usually you have to activate as well as deactivate the depth buffer in it. So we'll be using for activation GL enable, for deactivation we'll be using GL disable function. So those were some basic depth buffer functions. To study in detail about the OpenGL depth buffer functions, we actually have another function called as GL clear depth with respect to max depth as an parameter. So what is this function? We use this so that we can apply depth buffer testing using some other initial value for the maximum depth, and the initial value is chosen with the OpenGL function. So what is the initial value we saw? That is the maximum value which can be given for depth buffer is 1. Suppose if you want to give another values with respect to the depth buffer, with respect to maximum depth as a parameter for that particular statement, you can use GL clear depth by using max depth by giving the values for it. That is, it might be any values, but the initial value can be set between 0 to 1. That is, the initial value starts from 0 to 1. You can start giving the values from 0, 1, so on, so that you can increase the maximum depth of that particular algorithm, that is the depth buffer function. Then projection coordinates in OpenGL are normalized to the range minus 1 to 1, and the depth values between the near and far clipping planes are further normalized to range 0 to 1. That is, this basically depends, whatever the values you give here, that is 0 to 1, basically depends on the coordinates we are using. We are using the projection coordinates here so that you can normalize the range of this particular max depth from minus 1 to 1, but the initial value given for this particular max depth is usually 0 to 1 itself, which is being stated in the last statement. So those are the depth ranges which we can give. So as an option with respect to those values, that is depth buffer functions, we have something called as GL depth range. What happens in GL depth range is it has two parameters, that is near normalization depth as well as far normalization depth. So in these two parameters, the default values of these two parameters will be 0 to 1. As I told, the range of the depth, whatever the function we have used here, max depth is 0 to 1. You can check out the depth range which is specified here, 0 as well as 1, right, which comes under the range which we have given there. So similarly, with respect to depth range function, we can set these two parameters by giving normal range, that is the near normal depth, as well as far normal depth within the range 0 as well as 1. So this is the function which can be used for giving the range of that particular depth buffer functions. Then we have actually another function called as GL depth function, which is taking the parameter test condition. That is, it is another option which is being available in OpenGL, which is the test condition that is to be used for the depth buffer routines. Why we use this GL depth function in OpenGL is it basically specifies what test condition you are using in the depth buffer function. So what is the parameter given to the function? It is as the condition, that is the test condition. So what does this, why is this test condition assigned to this particular function? Is this parameter test condition is assigned so that any one of the following 8 symbolic constants can be included in it. So it consists, this function GL depth function consists of different 8 test conditions. One is GLS, GL greater, equal, not equal, LE equal, GE equal, that is lesser than or equal, greater than or equal, never, which tell no points are processed, and then GL always. These are some of the parameters you can give, which basically tells you the condition values, okay? Then the default value for this parameter test condition is GLS. The initial value will be assigned to the depth function with the test condition, which consists of less value. Then similarly, there is a statement called, another option called GL depth marks, which consists of right stasis. Why is this used? This is used to state or give the program, that is OpenGL program, which basically specifies the depth buffer, what kind of state the program is in. It is in write mode or read, only read mode, only write mode, or both read and write mode. So with the help of this function, we can give the status of the depth buffer. So what is the parameter given to it? Write status. When write status is equals to true, which is the default value, both read from as well as write to the depth buffer is being initialized to it. If this parameter is given to false, the write mode for the depth buffer is disabled. Only reading values is being done with respect to the write status. So this is how depth buffer function works with respect to write status, which basically tells what is the status of the depth buffer. Is it in read mode or only in write mode, or in write or read mode? It basically depends on the parameter which you pass, if it is true or if it is false. Then we have wireframe surface visibility functions. What are these wireframe visibility functions? Basically, a wireframe display of a standard graphics object can be obtained in OpenGL by requesting that only its edges are to be generated. Basically, A format of wireframe is being generated in OpenGL, with the help of which you can request the OpenGL software to just give the edges of that particular object to be displayed onto the screen. We can do this with the help of a GL polygon mode by setting the program with GL polygon mode to give just the front and back face of that particular polygon by passing which kind of primitive GL line as its primitive. So this is the function we use to give to set the program to just give the front and back faces of the polygon. Then simultaneously we have depth queuing functions, as there were four important visibility detection functions, right? We also have depth queuing function. Why is this depth queuing function used? It is basically used to vary the brightness of an object as a function of its distance from the viewing position. Whatever the view position is located from the object, it basically tells from that particular position what is the brightness of that particular object. So the brightness of the object can be given using GL enable GL fog, which tells the brightness that is with respect to fog element. Then we use GL fog eye, which basically used for two parameters, GL fog mode as well as GL linear, which basically applies the depth function to the object, which consists of some minimum as well as maximum value distance. That is, the minimum value of that particular value is zero, and then the maximum will be one. But the range lies between 0 and 1. So with respect to these parameters, the brightness of an object is being identified with the help of depth queuing. Then similarly, we have different values which can be used for maximum as well as minimum by passing as the function calls by. Check out the function here, GL fog eye, which basically tells you the index of that particular object. But check out, there is F here. What does this tell? It basically tells this is a floating point value with respect to the index, which consists of function calls GL fog start as well as minimum depth as well as maximum depth. What are the parameters given? That is, minimum depth as well as maximum depth are given a floating point value, that is F here. Although the integer values can be used if we change the function suffix as I here. If you are giving integer value for minimum depth as well as maximum depth, you can change I here. If you are giving it as a floating point value, you can give F here. So these are the depth queuing functions to be studied with respect to the program. These are some of the OpenGL visibility detection functions. As I told, all the four are being explained in the PPT. So as I finish up with the OpenGL visibility detection functions, so this is the end of your module 4. So where the module ends, it ends to OpenGL visibility detection functions. So students, we have finished the module 4 as well. Check out if you have any doubts in the module 4 by referring the notes as well as question bank. Before doing that, just take a glance of the slides which we studied today. We studied Z buffer or backface detection algorithm, which is a Z buffer algorithm, or I can call it as Z buffer or depth buffer algorithm as well. So this was the algorithm we studied, which had two methodologies in it. One is inside outside test as well as surface as its back face. Then we studied the limitations of it, advantages and disadvantages. Then we studied OpenGL visibility detection functions, the four different visibility detection functions. One is polygon, culling, depth buffer, wireframe as well as